Yes, sir.
Special special. Babaw yan ko sa iyo, sir, kasi dati pinahirapan mo sa sabay. I also have another confession to make. This warms my heart because many years ago, a couple of individuals went up to Baguio and to basically have a strategic planning session. Those individuals, actually, I was one of them. I brought them to PMA. And then when we went to PMA, there was a silent film exhibition. And the silent film exhibition, actually, I was with my boss then.
Really,
he told me, JJ, we should help.
Presentation ni Mayor. Siyang sunod na speaker.
Kaya alam mo, nakadive pa tayo.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, was the start of what would be known as the PGS. And the gentleman that told me was the gentleman that spoke to you yesterday, my mentor, Dr. Jesus Tanislaw. ISA before was just a project from a foundation called the Foundation for Community Building in Asia Pacific. We started the PGS before it became PGS. And now seeing this makes me really very proud. So I have since moved on from that life of being an NGO. And let me just go through my presentation very quickly. I was laboring over this presentation because I normally speak here and abroad about strategy execution, and most of my presentations are largely very technical. Now, I cannot be too technical today for two reasons. One is time, and two, it will cost you more. Okay. If only I could make this work, life would be much better. There you go. See, there will be, my agenda will be three points. I will talk to you about my worldview. I will have a dig at the conference team. I asked General Maraceros last night if I have intellectual freedom to challenge conventional thinking. I was given a go signal to do so. So without being irreverent, sir, I will challenge, as I always do in many of my presentations. Despite the fact that I do have quite a number of my upperclassmen here today. My worldview, as your worldviews, are shaped by many things. First, by my experience. It is very important to present to you the context to which I will be making my presentation this morning. I have quite a confusing experience. I used to be a military officer. I used to run an NGO. Basically, I was the founding executive director of ISA many years ago. Was the president and CEO of the Institute of Corporate Directors. I was with the Philippine Stock Exchange. I was a regulator as well for a couple of years. I was a consultant, an advisor to governments. I was a consultant to the government of Bhutan and quite a number of governments, including the Philippines. Author and contributor of a number of standards, both local and international. And now I am at Indero. I work for the Metro Retail Stores Group. We opened our 50th store downtown in Adria. And I sit in the board of a couple of companies. I've talked about some education that I had, some countries that I work in, and basically in the areas of enterprise reform, specifically on corporate governance, social responsibility, strategy design, and execution. Where should I be pointing this? All right, okay. The conference theme talked about transformation. Now, that caught my eye because I believe I have built a career around enterprise reform and transformation. This is about transformation. The theme talked about transformation. But good governance through transformation. Do we have a working understanding, therefore, of what good governance looks like? Do we know what it looks like? What impact will a strong partnership between police and community have on achieving that aspiration? In short, are our efforts here leading to something of value? Or are we just here to exercise, you know, mental calisthenics, if you may? Is the PNP patrol plan the way to go about it? How many plans are there? Is it robust enough? And then, of course, how can advisory councils add value? Okay, some questions I have in mind as I was preparing for this presentation. Let me talk about strategy execution, but before I do so, let me say something. Let me say that the future belongs to those who can execute. The world is no longer about the brilliance of strategy. It is now about the excellence in execution. I have spoken and attended a number of international conferences, and what do they say about Filipinos? You are very good in terms of generating ideas. We are thought leaders. I sit in a number of boards and a number of advisory councils here in abroad. And they always say there's a lot of good ideas that we get out from you Filipinos. But unfortunately, we can't make things happen. And that's where actually my dedication and commitment to the field of strategy execution became a little bit more intense. Because I think Filipinos can do and actually can execute. So, it is no longer again about the brilliance in strategy. Okay? It's the excellence in execution that creates value. And what then would be the role of the advisory councils in that value creation exercise? But first, let us get aligned. Now, this is a framework that I developed for a client I had in India. The largest beer company in India, called Kingfisher. I walked into a room of about 45 Indians. Three-fourths of them actually went to either Harvard, Wharton, a bunch of very brilliant people. And they asked me one question. Jay, what is the relationship between mission, values, operations, strategy, and all of these things? I said, okay, let me try to show you what does and how do they relate to each other. So of course, since I served in the Navy, I used the ship as an example. Mission, if we are an organization, is like a ship. Our mission is what we do. And our reason for existence, our vision is where we want to go to. Our strategy is how to get there. Right? Now, our strategy can never be a straight line. For those of you who say it are familiar, when we say that we anticipate certain known knowns. So shoals, shallow portions, we avoid. That's why when we plan our strategy, we avoid it as well. Operations is represented by the green arrows we see. As much as possible, we operate close to what we said we were going to do. Sometimes very difficult in many organizations because a lot of time, resources, and emotion are dedicated towards crafting of the strategy, and we go back to our offices and do the usual stuff. We hardly actually make a conscious effort to bring operations close to strategy. That should not be the case. So if you notice here, the green arrows actually point away from strategies because there are certain unknowns that you encounter. Like in this case, a passing ship or a storm. So you avoid. Operations allows you to avoid and stray away from strategy for as long as you go back. Okay? And then the red lines now signify your value system. Meaning, even when you plan your strategy, you plan a strategy that does not deviate from your values. Even if there is a crisis, you do not deviate from the values. That should be how values are to be interpreted and worked on. They are not just nice statements engrossed in a nice brass plaque at the lobby of your respective offices. Values should be lived, and values should define what you can do as planned and what you are doing based in operations. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is a little attempt at trying to put together what these core principles that we will be referring to the next few slides. I just want to make all ourselves aligned to that. See, consultants like me actually could not do away without having to present a 2x2 matrix, no? That's how we earn our living. So there's a strategy and there's execution. There's a wrong strategy and a right strategy. There's a wrong execution and right execution. And there you go, the 2x2 matrix that we consultants are notorious for. When you hire consultants, they show you a 2x2 matrix in charge and arm and a leg. Okay, wrong strategy, right execution. Better than anyone would have expected. I had clients like that actually bringing me in and say, Jay, we are very successful, we don't do what we're doing right. Please help us figure that out. It's possible and that works. Right strategy, wrong execution. A lot of organizations experience this, and one of the things that you see when this happens is that good people start to leave. And when you do your exit interviews, you say, why are you leaving? Sir, you know what? I know what to do, but we just couldn't seem to do it. Unlike in mathematics, where negative is negative, it's positive. Wrong strategy executed incorrectly, disaster. This is what we're doing. This is what we're aiming for. A stunning victory that is brought about by good execution and a good strategy. That's our objective. Do you have strategy execution challenges? I believe so. I was here yesterday and I heard quite a few of them, right? But let me show you a result of a survey that I did many years ago on an organization, not the Philippine National Police, but on an one of the organizations, the armed forces, regarding their similar exercise. So let's see. It is very important for us to understand, when we talk about execution, to understand what I would call the execution context. And let's listen to what they have to say. Some senior leaders are not participating in driving strategy execution. They don't even understand strategy at all. Think about this if you listen to this. For the officers and those personnel assigned in headquarters, most especially in the zone, they are well informed. But as you go further away from the zone, they're less informed. Senior leaders are not that much focused on strategy. They don't think differently. Senior leaders who oppose the execution of the strategy or the strong sense of direction comes from the top leaders. Senior leaders were not able to articulate a convincing portrait of the future. We have yet to completely get in need of legacy map or empire building plan. Let's listen very closely some more. If the staff do not meet their targets, for now, nothing will happen. The horizontal alignment remains a challenge. Strategy is set aside if there's a pressing operational concern. At operating level, nuances and changes are not communicated well, and so on and so forth. More strategic workshop for commanders instead of operations officers. There is weakness in cascading strategy. I play golf every Saturday, and I play golf with my military buddies. We talk about their transformation programs, and I still hear this 4, 5, 6 years after they started it. And I would venture on a guess that probably not all, some of these remain relevant. I presented this to a group of PNP officers a couple of years ago, and they said, it is relevant. So I would say that it still is relevant. You do have your own strategy execution challenges as well. Lack of commitment, participation, and representation, and lack of resources, unsupported PNP units, frequent leadership changes, so on and so forth, scorecard issues, weak staff support, uninformed. Many areas, many challenges and weaknesses, all advisory councils. Lesson, if somebody tells you that execution is easy, don't believe them. It is never easy. That's where the value is most created, when you get it right. Just, I will be struggling my examples from public sector and private sector, because a lot of you are not having the private sector. You know that the hit rate of strategy based on empirical data is just 10%. 9 out of 10 strategies developed are not executed as planned. Thus, the odds are stacked against us. 7 out of 10 CEOs who fail to execute do not do so because of wrong strategy but because of poor execution. So on and so forth. There is a 5-year survey from Harvard Business Review saying 3 out of 5 companies or organizations cannot execute strategy. It's never easy. Again, but strategy is very important. Not two. Why? There are 5 to 6 basic barriers to strategy we have to be mindful of. And intellectual debt is owed to my previous firm, Iloilo, because they did this study. Only 5% of a company is aware of what the strategy is. None of them. Only 25% of managers have incentives linked to strategy. I remember working for a banking client that I had, wherein we started to try and drive the behavior of bank managers trying to sell trust products. They were selling credit. The trust products could not be sold mainly because the bank managers' incentives were actually them versus them selling credit products. So meaning if you want your managers to sell trust, incentivize them to sell trust products. But the point being is that you make your incentive system to the behavior you would like to see. Third, many strategies are not resourced. I heard presentations yesterday, there's so many plans, but if your plans are not resourced, do not expect it to be implemented. Resourced from the standpoint of economic funds, from the standpoint of human resource, tao, and from the standpoint of management, time, and attention. We always forget the third component. It is not only about the money or the people, but the executive mind share. It's something that is a very important resource for people to be able to get things done. And finally, 85% of executive teams do not talk about strategy. Many of you perhaps think about strategy as a once a year discussion. It should not be. My recommendation is to have it at least once a month. Okay? It's just like trying to check your blood pressure. I had a blood pressure issue before, and my doctor said I had to check my blood pressure once or twice a day. Imagine if I said I check it once every 2 weeks. The more frequent the checking, the better it is for you to have the ability to course correct. Okay, we talk about quality strategy, quality execution. You can exceed expectations with excellent execution of an average strategy. However, you can miss expectations with a below average execution of an excellent strategy. Again, a lot of time is dedicated to a strategy. In fact, right now, I am challenging the whole concept of strategy planning and planning horizon. This is one of the things, sir, that I am challenging. Because conventionally, the current thinking right now is that the planning horizons, progressive CEOs, progressive leaders, have planning horizons of not more than 12 months. The focus of progressive leaders right now are two things. Building high performance teams and a strong culture. It's about team. It's about culture. Because agility is now the name of the game. You can no longer predict, and I will talk to you later on about what are some of the tools that will prepare you for the future, the very future that you cannot predict. Because strategy execution depends a lot on what you do not know. Okay. Again, for those of you who appreciate, there is a premium of about 27% for organizations with formal strategy execution process. So the proposition, therefore, is we need to translate our vision into core operational initiatives that drive performance. The next confession I am going to make is that I did work for Bob and Dave, the developers of the balance scorecard, for a couple of years. I ran their Southeast Asia operations, and because of that, I had the opportunity to study, implement, and do a lot of strategy execution. I probably own, I think, one of the largest libraries of strategy execution books that I know of. I've spent a fortune on buying those books. I've read practically all of those books on strategy execution. But one thing that I noticed is that most of the strategy execution tools, including the balance scorecard, are complex. And the trick for strategy execution is to make it simple. So my attempt of putting together a body of knowledge is what I call the strategy execution pyramid. This is a concept that I developed about 2 or 3 years ago, and I first launched in Myanmar. The reason why I didn't launch it in the Philippines, because in the Philippines there are quite a number of very smart people. I launched it in Myanmar. After that, through a World Bank engagement, I relaunched it in Vietnam. And this is probably the only second time I am presenting this to a Filipino audience. So this is an attempt of simplifying what I think are the core principles of strategy execution in the Southeast Asian context. This is largely, again, defined and influenced by my own personal experience. So clarity, alignment, governance, and people. For those of you who are active students of strategy execution would notice that the literature in strategy execution is long in process but short in people. To be able to get things done, the core of execution, I submit, is to get the people side right. And that is going to be the theme of my presentation. No amount of scorecards will do it. No amount of systems and whatever that is. I haven't talked to you about a few of them. But unless you have the human capital base that will make this run, execution, at least from my standpoint, will not happen the way we want it to happen. First, on clarity. One of the things, and this one I could tell you in public, when I did the strategy for non-bank, when we did the strategy, we started to think about various scenarios. It is very important for you, in my view, when you do strategy, to ascertain what are the plausible futures. Because the world is changing. Your strategy should be future-proof. And to be able to make it future-proof, you have to do a bit of scenario planning. It's a 1 or 2 minute exercise. You validate the strategy anchors, I talked about affiliations, mission values, continuous to refresh strategy. And these are some of the questions I'd like to leave you with. Some framing questions that you might want to ask. First, what is our collective aspiration for the organization? In the context of that aspiration, what would be our distinguishing characteristic as a unit? These are some of the guide questions you might might want to ask yourself, the answers to which should be very clear to you. Because if there is not much clarity on the answers to this question, you will now sacrifice, in my view, one of the core components of effective strategy execution, which is clarity. Get clarity on this. What do we need to do to deliver? Who will take us forward? What are the accountabilities, the roles, responsibilities, decision-making lines, and so on and so forth? These are just the basic questions that you will have. Some, just break it down. The aspiration, the things, you're familiar with this, objectives. I guess you're more familiar with this, strategy maps. I guess you're familiar with that. Scenario planning again, I just like to show a slide here. The goal of scenario planning is not to find certainty but to create a map of uncertainty. See, many of the frustrations in strategy, as well in the strategy design, is its inflexibility. So you make your strategy more robust if you inform it with this scenario planning exercise. In some of my experience when I have the chance and opportunity, I even do wargaming and simulation. So these are some of the tools that you might want to have. This one I'd like to share with you because this is one of my favorite topics when we talk about execution. The articulation of the values and vision statement. A classic example that I have is two organizations I work closely with. I work more with the World Bank. See the vision of the World Bank. To end extreme poverty by 2030, end extreme poverty by decreasing the percentage of people living in the less than 125 and so on and so forth. Not sexy at all. Asian Development Bank, an Asia Pacific free of poverty. Bumper sticker, short, sweet, nice. Good. From a communication standpoint, you might want to refer to this. But a strategy execution professional like me, I have a different point of view. These two vision statements are being used globally right now. But listen, which one is more friendly to strategy execution? When a World Bank employee wakes up in the morning, that World Bank employee would say, what year is it? What is now the percentage of people living in less than 125%? What then is income group? There is a framework for this strategy. This strategy facilitates execution. An ADB, no, nothing against ADB, but an ADB employee will wake up in the morning and say, I'll go free Asia Pacific of poverty, whatever I do. So meaning, when you articulate an aspiration, articulate an aspiration in a way that it facilitates strategy execution. Because in this case, you now are more or less clear on what you are going to do. So again, challenging conventional thinking here. Be more specific. Might sacrifice for lack of better term sexiness, but be more specific. It starts there. We are a big fan of acronyms. Fine. Use those acronyms, but make sure those acronyms inform strategy and facilitate strategy execution. Okay. Alignment. We have to effectively communicate strategy. One of the weaknesses that I've seen in a lot of these transformation programs is that strategy is communicated but not cascaded. You have to talk more about what cascading means as opposed to communication. Ensure alignment between operating support units. I just want to show you something which is a little bit more a budget incentive. Talk about that. This one is a a bit more visual. Align the individuals to the corporate or to the student. There has to be a line of sight, but there are steps. There are steps of cascading, and I understand cascading has been done. That's the vertical alignment. This alignment actually creates value, but not as much. Because this is defined basically, vertical alignment is easy to do because it's defined by the hierarchy. The boss, you know, boss, facilitate, it's easy. But not the, only 20% of the value is created there. Horizontal alignment is to where most value is created in, whether in the uniform services sector or in the private sector. Because this horizontal alignment, alignment among equals, is where value is created, but it's more difficult. Why? This is not defined by hierarchy. This is defined by relationships. I will only work with this person to help this person because I like him or her. It's very difficult to institutionalize. But if you are able to do so and facilitate horizontal alignment, then you will be able to be in a better position to execute your strategy. And then external alignment. Align yourselves with your external environment. I heard that there can be some improvements that could be done by aligning the PNP, the NAPOLCOM, the DILG, and the AFP. There has to be that alignment with the external shareholders as well. Because no organization that I know of actually live in a vacuum. This is what I normally tell my clients to do when they start to think about aligning themselves. Look up. Look around, look within. Look up when a department actually refers to a higher set of objectives. That's looking up. You look around when a department actually looks. That's the horizontal alignment. Of other departments and evaluate which of these is relevant and in support. And look within, what is your mandate? So your mandate, what are you being told to do, and what your colleagues and your equals are actually doing, how you support. So it's a more holistic way of aligning you with the organization. Strategy communication, very important. Tell a story. No? You do not communicate a troll plan or whatnot. Tell that story. By the way, I could say that the PNP is one of the better performing, based on my experience, huh? Better performing in terms of communicating this. One of my jobs in the current position right now is to go around the Philippines to look for sites where we will build our stores. And invariably, I will find myself passing by a police precinct or detachment, and I would almost always see the patrol plan there. I just went through renewing my firearms license, and I would line up, and I would see in their monitors the, what you call, patrol plan. It's a very good step to do that. In Central Plan, I was the strategy execution consultant for 4 years. They have their mouse pad. It's the strategy of, it's a very good discipline that you guys have. And I suppose that you go on and strengthen it and improve on it. I am almost tempted to ask those police precinct commander to explain to me what the patrol plan is, but that's the outline. Okay, get leaders, I'll talk more about this later on, communicate actual performance. I will be giving you a copy of this presentation, and we'll be giving the second guide a copy of this presentation. For those of you who would like to listen to governance. It is very important to monitor and evaluate. They're very critical tools. Give management the information to make decisions about changes that are necessary in our strategy. I'll show you more about this later on. These meetings, I don't know how your meetings run, but I went to far too many meetings where we just talk about, spend so much time and energy on minor stuff. The more significant stuff are not, you know, this talked about enough. No? So the current way of many meetings is that strategic issues 30%, implications 30%, and review of past performance 40%. It's just like driving a car and looking at the rear view mirror 40% of the time. Imagine yourself driving a car and 40% of the time your attention is in the rear view mirror. It's very dangerous for you to move on. The recommendation that we have is that spend less than 10% on past performance. Talk about more strategic issues and discuss their implication. More forward thinking. Structure your meetings in a way where they are value creating. In my organization, I would always refer to them as a couple of things. We do not, in meetings, you do not want to discover. In meetings, you do not want to diagnose. In meetings, you want to deliberate and you want to decide. After the meeting, you will disseminate. Okay? Before the meeting, you discover. Right? During the meeting, you discuss, deliberate, decide. After the meeting, you disseminate. You do not diagnose and discover during the meeting. That is not a value creating. And I've been to many of those where you discuss, especially when you're presented with raw data, it really, if I only had here, I would put it up anyway. Okay, strategy review meetings, focus on the performance of objectives, not the measure. For those of you who are about the balance scorecard, you always talk about the measure. Spend a lot of dimes a day on the measure. What are the measures telling us? Root causes, our initiatives on track, what are the action steps, and then discuss and agree on the revenue of issues. And just again, some tips. OSM, you have OSMs already. I suppose that the OSMs function in this role. My favorite part, people. Many organizations' source of competitive advantage is people. Then progressive organizations prioritize and emphasize the importance of human capital. Let us take a moment and let us reflect. When was the last time did we have an honest-to-goodness discussion on how we are developing our people as individuals and more importantly as teams? Okay? We may have a strong team, strong individuals, but unless they work together, they cannot move the organization as fast as we want the organization to move. Again, the training and capability building should be as individuals and as teams. So, think about, as advisory councils, in the units that you advise and also in the organizations that you run yourselves, this can also be very relevant for you. Look at how you compensate, the benefits you give, the org structure, personal administration, recruitment, organization, many things. When I was asked to join the organization I am in, and they asked me to help facilitate execution, the first thing that I did was to tell them that the first department that I need to have strategic oversight over is HR. So that was the first thing I did. I was head of HR for 3 months just to sort out the strategic human capital development agenda of the organization. Then turn it over to another HR person. And then soon after that, right now there are 8 departments reporting to me: HR, IT, and all the things, all again, that completes the strategy execution story. Okay, I will talk about something that is probably a challenge in the PhD because you are guided by certain things, but maybe there are not many of you from the advisory council. The days of stable, placid, and predictable environments are over, making the workplace an extremely difficult landscape to navigate. Average age in the Philippines is what? 23 to 25. A huge component of our workforce are coming from the millennials. Right? A huge component for our constituencies, millennials. How much do we understand of how millennials take an act? It's extremely difficult. Now, there are two types of employees that quit an organization. Those that quit and leave. But we'd be worried of those that quit and stay. Maraming po yan. There are quite a number of them. And they become a load. They become a weight. And they become a barrier. Ito yung mga tao na sasabing, wala yan. Wala ito. Hindi pwede yan. Hindi pwede. Ang dami po yan. Be worried. You want to execute, make sure you identify who are those who have quit but have decided to stay. Address them. Very important. Then a few things here about motivation. It is not, it's my point of view, it's not a management job to motivate the staff. Motivation is the manager's job to make sure that the environment is conducive for them to motivate themselves. I cannot call a junior officer and say, go, be motivated, huh? Just couldn't do that. You cannot dictate motivation. You can create an environment where motivation happens. And that is what I think managers should have. You cannot execute strategy, I'll talk about that towards the end, unless you energize the organization. An organization that is tired and demotivated do not and cannot execute the strategy. Performance management system is something that you need to take a look at, especially for you, those who are flexible in this. It must involve in design, a build a strategy and focus performance management system. It must involve relevant to everyone. You have to drive organizational behavior. It is not about forms but process. Customize, measure, and manage, and so on and so forth. Point being is that review your performance management systems regularly. I would say every 3 to 5 years, you take a look at your performance management system. I do not know in the armed forces that we used to have the OER, Officers Evaluation Report. In the PNP, I do not know what is the equivalent of that. But it might be good for you to review the OER, Performance Management System. It is very important and integral part of strategy execution. It is important to make organizations understand the strategy execution is serious. Change management is important. As advisory council members, make sure that you facilitate effective change management. It is not enough to say that you are advising a uniform organization that actually is, kasi uniform services, pag sinabi mo, gagawin ka agad. There has to be some change management as well. So, as to sustain performance gaps, we need to a culture of underperformance. Pag pinalabas nyo po, yung pasensya na Bisaya ko, pag pinalabas nyo yung mediocre performance, it will just reinforce itself and it will become a norm. And people will now start to accept mediocre performance. And guess what? Your star performers will start to underperform because it disincentivizes them to perform. So it's very important for you under your performance management system to make sure that the good performers are recognized and the poor performers are also attentions are called. You have to build the confidence of your managers. Yes, we can. Kaya natin to. Note that the target audience of the strategy changes. You have to be mindful that the audience of the strategy changes and is not constant. Be mindful of that. Informal networks play a different role, a very important role in strategy execution. Many of you perhaps know this, that the secretaries play a very important role. The secretaries of the bosses, I will tell you, in our organization, are key to strategy execution. In Congress, perhaps the chiefs of staff actually play a very important role. When in my previous life, we were able to pass an executive, to help facilitate the passing of an executive order. We had to work with the secretaries for many of these government functionalities. Informal networks play a big role. Build a dedicated knowledge management program. Capture the ideas in a very formal and deliberate way. Align human resources to the business strategy and a few other things on leadership for execution. Okay, I'll skip the case studies. I just want to show you one. This was a case study. I didn't intellectual debt. I tried to get data from my previous firm. This was the work that the firm did for the Iloilo Canadian Mounted Police. It's just, I just wanted to show that what you are doing right now is what we did for the Canadian police many years ago. And the same that we did for the Royal Dubai, Abu Dhabi police. The whole idea is cascading. The whole idea is to develop champions. The whole idea is to get as many stakeholders involved. What precisely what the PNP is doing. This is just, these two case studies is just to basically reinforce what you are already doing. Now, conclusion. Advisory councils as catalysts for execution. Make a compelling case for change and socialize it. What does that mean? As advisory council members, I encourage you to show a burning platform to the units. This is very important. Make a compelling case for change. Tell them how important and why they should change. Then do a self-assessment. Identify major performance dimensions. As advisory councils, limit it to 3, 4, or perhaps 5. Just say, we want to see change in these 5 areas. I know you want to see change in all. Pick the top five that will move the needle the most. Remember the Pareto principle, 80%, 20%. Perhaps 20% of the issues will account for 80% of the total impact on the organization. Look for that, 3 to 5. What are these? Then assess and see if there is a meaningful stretch. Do not ask for the moon and the stars. Diba? Ano sabi nun? Wagas sa pag-iing, something like that. Do not ask for that. And look for areas where there is strategic shift. What is a strategic shift? There would be a shift that is fundamental. And that's really where transformation happens. When there is a strategic shift, look for that. People say there are low-lying fruits, it's good, you have to have low-lying fruits. But as advisory councils, look for the 3 or 4 or 5 that would make sure that after you're done with them, you say they are now a different organization. Connect them to the strategy and understand the execution context. I started this presentation by trying to explain to you my point of view, the context, and then the challenges. Understand the execution context. What are the drivers of non-performance? What are the drivers of performance? What are the motivations, influences? External. Okay, and this is where I would say, sirs, ma'ams of the advisory council, please, 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 create an emotional spark. You are external to the organization. Excite them. Give them, give them that excitement, give them that energy that you alone can bring. The Philippine National Police is an organization I feel that needs a re-energization. They're tired, they're battled, they're bruised. As advisory council members, energize them. Create an emotional spark because you provide that validation. You provide that validation to them. You are the pat on the back. Listen to them, empathize with them. There's only one thing that I would like to leave you with today. As members of the advisory council, it would be this. Create that spark. Challenge conventional thinking and status quo. I belong to the armed forces. I belong to a particular dispensation, very, rigid mindset. We adhere to a certain set of norms, standards, and traditions. But I am one now, moved on, would say, this is coming from somebody from the military. We need to be challenged. We need to be challenged. Our conventional thinking might have been brought about by the circumstances that were made that made them valid in the past. Perhaps they need no longer be so. Here is another concept that I'd like to leave you with. Focus on the middle management. They are at the cutting edge. You want execution done either in the police or in the private sector? Middle management is the key. Treat them like VIPs. Listen to them. Empower them. Train them. Develop them. They're your secret sauce. Celebrate with honesty. And again, tell the story. First, my request to tell the story, spread the good word. My final thought, clarity. You cannot manage something you cannot measure, but also you cannot manage something you cannot describe. If you cannot describe your strategy, you cannot describe your aspirations, you cannot manage it. Important learning and clarity. Alignment. This one you may want to listen. If you want to change the results, change the behavior. If you want to change the behavior, change the way you measure behavior. You cannot expect different results with the same set of behaviors. Okay? My goal, what I do for my client organizations is always 60% of their current KPIs I will change. I will change 60% of the current KPIs. Now start thinking. CPSM. Can you change 60% of your current set of KPIs? I do not know. But do not be afraid to invent KPIs. Just make sure that they lean towards the behavior that you want them to see. Change result, change behavior. Change behavior, change pressure. People react to what is inspected, not what is expected. We all think that we are all professionals here, that you know we already told you what to do, and you do it wrong. Behavior scientist says that we are no different from kids on two matters. We can only absorb three core ideas in 1 hour, and we only do things if we are being monitored. People react to what is inspected, not what is expected. So strategy review meetings. Very important. Constant monitoring. Adult supervision is very important. Hindi pwede yung, kapata, alam niyo na yung gagawin natin, ha? Okay, let's go. Trust, but verify. Okay? People, strategy execution is not about metrics. So do not spend much time on tama ba yung measure ko, tama ba yung objective ko. I did that for a living. Up to now, I'm doing that. It's not about the metrics. It's about change. It's about people. Focus on the people. You have the right set of people there. Now, I apologize if you have been hearing differently from different sources. This is just my point of view based on my experiences, okay? And my view of the world. Make sure leaders and managers have a sense of ownership. If they do not own the system, no one will. Make sure executive meetings are not spontaneous. Prioritize subjects that really matter. And finally, building an SFO is a journey. It does not happen overnight. At least for strategy execution, do not believe in miracles. Hard work. Strategy execution, hard work. And meron pala. Strategy execution is powered by extra human energy. Tap into it. As advisory council members, look for that. Look for that source of extra human energy. Energize. That's why I go back to the negative. You know, create that excitement. And I leave you with one last slide, which is, let's get it on. We can always work hard. We do better. But if we work differently, we get breakthrough results. At this point, we are at the cusp of actually having to do things differently. For those of you who went to Mass today, the Bible talks about the gospel was about the parable of the fig tree and how the blooms signify summer. The signs of summer and the bloom. And let this be the bloom of what will be a summer that we're looking forward to with your guidance, council members, and looking forward to a stronger PNP. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sir PNP. We will now open the floor to a very brief open forum. If you will only want to hear questions and keep your questions short and straight to the point. Do you have any questions from the body?
Either it's clear or they just want to go, open, go straight to the break.
I think very clear.
My head is clear.
Okay, so there are no questions. We don't come to the giving of a plaque of appreciation to our guest speaker. And for this, we will invite Mr. Next Iloilo. Okay, I'm sorry. Sir, Mr. Angelo Tobe from the NAGPD. Would like to ask a question.
Morning, sir.
Yes, sir.
Looks like emotional smart.
Yes.
You give an example of your experience. How do we make that emotional spark being an advisory council of the people?
Yeah, at least those that I have, I bring the, in an organization, there are quite a number of influencers from various states, not only the higher headquarters or the hierarchy, you know. We would bring external people to say something nice or good about them. Sometimes it's an event. It's an event that we would, or a nice media, a press conference, or a publication, a coffee table book about that. It really depends on what moves them. But the concept of having a conscious effort to say, what would excite these people? Some say that what would excite them are some material things. Laptop, a computer lab, I don't know. Some would be just a reinforcement, telling the public how good you are. So it'll be different for different groups. And that would be, you could go to that by trying to ask them, try to read them, but what would be good for them. Yes, sir.
Sir, last night, yes, sir.
or backslide back.
Good morning, sir. My name is Juan, I'm Rat 9. You mentioned something about implementing effective change management program that focuses on the structure of engaging people.
Yes.
How can you effectively do this in an organization like the PNP that is already so set in its structure? Especially from an advisory council, the perspective of an advisory council. We are here to advise us, but yet they have to stick to their own old system. How can you put the most effective people in place?
Well, admittedly, that would be a source for, a challenge really because of the structure. But I have had experience where we were able to, this was not for the police, but we were able to introduce a new structure, a new practice. For example, in the Navy, part of the promotion system actually would require for a promotable officer to present his or her scorecard. And that was working within the current structures, but modifying, enhancing it with a lot of this program. And that was very successful. We could force literally everybody to have a personal scorecard. It's actually part of their promotion system.
I ask a question, because especially from our experience in Iraq, we have officers who are really effective in handling Iraq, for example.
Right.
And yet you have, once he gets out of, he's promoted, you end up with the next in rank taking over, and he may not be that committed, he may not have the same vision as the
okay. What we did in other organizations that we worked on is we identified the potential successors, about 5 or 6 of them. We sold the concept to them, and then by selling the concept to them, and we were lucky that of the 5, we worked obviously with appropriate individuals to identify that for this particular position, there are about 5 or 6 candidates. And we sold them the idea. So that's what I said about hard work. Selling succession planning is also very important.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. We have one more. Ask the first, Sir Sabine.
I will be around anyway, so I do have the
question.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, sir. My question is actually related to what's happening right now. Your suggestion of creating a spark so that they are the systems inside the PNP are more motivated. So my question is that do you firmly believe that the current gains or wins of the PNP is enough for them to have that spark, including the backing of the less than the president of the country, that they should do their job and the president will be at their back? Do you think that is the spark, or do you think that is not the spark?
It is obviously a spark that I would leverage on, but not totally back on. It is just one of the very important sparks. I say this publicly all the time. Del Barcelos would attest to this. This is the PNP's sweet spot. This time of age is the PNP sweet spot, and I have been a keen observer of many transformation programs here abroad. You have your sweet spot today. This is the best time to create those sparks. The president's support, the popularity of the chief PNP is that spark. It has to be sustained and complemented with other little sparks around. So yes, sir, I believe it is a spark.
Thank you for your questions. We're running short on time. If you do have any questions, go ahead to Sir Moreno after this. So we now come, sir, to the giving of a round of appreciation for this speaker and next year. And maybe we can start with the second, and this is the other member of the Council of Iloilo. Sir, to give the plaque to our speaker, also to the chief superintendent of the
MPS. Ayos, pinalawa kasi hindi pa nag-overtime.
for the following six outstanding categories in financial administration, disaster preparedness, social protection, business friendliness and competitiveness, peace and order, and environmental protection. And of course, the most livable city in the Livable City Designs Competition by the National Competitiveness Council Philippines, or NCCP. Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker, the man of vision and outstanding performance, the mayor of the city of Iloilo, the Honorable Gen. Patrick E. Mabilo.
Police Chief Superintendent, Senatines, Judge Senatinesan, the Honorable John Tarosa, Chairman of the Regional Advisory Council, Mayor of Saraga, members of the National Advisory Group for Police Transformation Development, Mr. Lex Trilon, the participants, members of the National Advisory Group, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Blessed morning, Christian. Mayong mga gamit, sinin na pa natin. Mayong mga gamit. The Iloilo City Government has strengthened programs to strongly promote five investment priority areas. Namely, we are strong in services, human resource and overseas Filipino workers, tourism, utilities such as power, water and transportation, and ICT and BPO. Investors' confidence is very high, as giant developers have seen and experienced our capabilities to sustain our exponential business growth, making them pursue their expansion plans. They are currently fulfilling their 150 billion peso worth of investments in the city through construction and services. We are now enjoying the fruits of labor and productive results of the Iloilo Business Summit, which we initiated in Makati City 2 years ago, or in 2014. All these things came about as a result of our investments in performance governance system, PGS, initiated by my predecessor, former mayor, now Congressman Jerry P. Trenas. And this is the story of Iloilo that I would like to share with you today. I was invited to talk about Iloilo City becoming a model of performance and good governance in local government in relation to our being a Palladium Hall of Fame awardee. It was way back in 2005, on the second term of former Mayor Jenny Trenas, that the Institute of Solidarity in Asia, or ISA, took notice of Iloilo City's progressive and development-oriented leadership. ISA soon made the city a pioneer member of the National Coalition for Good Governance and Responsible Citizenship, along with seven other cities. It introduced to Iloilo City the Performance Governance System, or PGS, an adaptation of the balanced scorecard to the Philippine scenario. Prior to ISA, we were not aware that the balanced scorecard could be applied to public organizations, much more to local government units. But through the efforts of Dr. Jess Stanislao, who was here with us yesterday, Christian Saints, and Mr. Rex Trilon and the ISA team, it was localized and translated into the four-stage installation through the PGS or the performance governance system. At that time, I was still a city councilor, but I saw that the system could work. Thus, we supported our mayor in its journey towards governance, towards the institutionalization of the PGS. The vision statement was employed in our comprehensive land use plan, wherein the programs for city development were aligned and prioritized to achieve this vision. Prior to the PGS, the delivery of public service was then far from being efficient, and people were working in government were perceived to be incompetent. And when there is incompetence, everybody is seen in the government to be corrupt. There was no plan to development and big challenges for the executive leadership. It was not easy to introduce change, much more employ an approach that promoted change. The issue of change is not uncommon. Dr. Stanislaw, in his past experience of building and rehabilitating organizations, has seen the culture barrier to be a major battle to hurdle. The process of initiating the city into the performance governance system, as is done with all organizations, thus began with the formulation of the city's charter statement with the vision of becoming a premier city in the year 2015. That was way back in 2005, and we wanted to be a premier city by the year 2015. This would be the battle cry of the city, and it was created with the help of the city's multi-sector coalition for Iloilo City, or we call MUSIC. A coalition of 72 representatives from government, media, youth, the elderly, PWDs, academic, civic organizations, professionals committed to work together to make a difference in significantly improving public governance. The group was organized for so that the city's vision would be created with everyone, and thus would be achieved with the help and support of everyone. The group then made its roadmap, composed of 12 objectives, towards achieving its vision of being a premier city. We wanted to be a vibrant city, we wanted to be the center for arts, culture, and sports, a world-class, healthy, productive population, world-class convention and tourism center, progressive mass communication industry, equal access to basic services, dynamic public governance system, adequate housing and human settlement, center for advanced knowledge and learning, a major hub for export and manufacturing, an integrated transport system, and a major financial center, thus resulting to a progressive revenue collection program to make Iloilo City a premier city in the year 2015. The advent of ESA has given Iloilo City an opportunity to address its key stumbling blocks and refocus its vision from just being a regional center to becoming a premier city by 2015, and to embrace good governance as a way to achieve the common good. With these accomplishments, Iloilo City's PGS roadmap was first publicly reported in a joint open conference in Makati, Shangri-La last August 10, 2005, where the city was conferred the PGS initiated status. A soft benefit was felt immediately after the city has been initiated to the ESA PGS. The success story of the management of the Dinagyang Festival, with the partnership of the tripartite government, church, and private foundation, which in the Iloilo City has submitted as best practice, being manifest a scheme that eventually became the regular arrangement for the various joint undertakings, which later gained us the recognition in the latest Galing Puok Award. For the information of everyone, the Dinagyang Festival is being operated by a foundation and the city government. The city government's contribution is only in providing the seed fund. But the sourcing of funds to support the Dinagyang, to run the Dinagyang Foundation, even the operation and management is being done by the private sector via a memorandum of agreement between the church, the city government, and the private sector. After having created the strategy of the city, it was then essential that it was given to all the necessary units. The use of the balanced scorecard. Take note, balanced scorecard has enabled the organization to communicate the strategies clearly to the workforce and to the constituents. In the second stage, the balanced scorecard for the city was created based on the strategy map, and it also became the scorecard of the mayor. This scorecard was composed of the measures and targets for the achievement of each of the 12 objectives set, as well as strategic initiatives or projects that would ensure that the targets would be achieved. When the city mayor created his scorecard, he automatically made himself city mayor accountable for the target set and communicated to everyone that he was indeed serious about achieving the goals of the city. Inspired by this show of commitment, each sector in music and each department of City Hall then created their own individual scorecards, aligned to the vision and goals in the city mayor's scorecard. The different units in the organization were thus no longer performing as different units, but part of one city aspiring to achieve one vision. With the focus on the strategic steps and projects that needed to be taken to achieve that, this was no mere organizational development. It means that the mayor was in serious business in implementing these objectives. It was a culture change, and this prepared the way for Iloilo City to become the model for private-public partnership. As its audit results would later show, after these achievements, Iloilo City was thus awarded a PGS-compliant insignia in another open conference dubbed as Mahalco ang Pilipinas in August 30 of 2006. In 2006, a year after the implementation, Dinagyang was chosen Best Tourism Event by the Association of Tourism Officers of the Philippines. The objective is to be the center of culture has driven the tripartite to institutionalize and professionalize the management of the celebration, as mentioned earlier. In 2007, the Asian Development Bank and the United Nations Development Program has accorded this partnership as best practice. Dinagyang still bested other festivals in the country with a second straight win of the Tourism Club. Thus, the festival was invited to represent the Philippines in the Texas Folklife Festival in San Antonio. The year 2008 was another banner year because it won the Grand Slam Prize from ATO. The roots of these successes lie in the unity and solidarity created by the PGS in its first two stages. Although this will take time to be cemented, it is expedient that the city begin as soon as possible with installing the change in culture. The city saw that indeed the benefits of the solidarity created was there. They wanted to continue the momentum, and the Office for Strategy Management, or the OSM, was thus created with an executive order. Its main task was to ensure the continued alignment of the staff and participation of the sectors, as well as to oversee the execution of the city's strategies. In January 2008, there was a boot camp that was conducted for our PGS Technical Working Group and focal persons, and they were there to revise the tools of measuring performance. As in any other boot camp, it took a lot of discipline, a lot of learnings for them to be able to come up with the different strategies for the implementation of the balanced scorecard. Thus, this forum has provided the creation of the balanced scorecard collaborative of the Palladium Group. Of course, topics tackled were about the LGU as an investment destination and the functions of the Office of Strategy Management. Therefore, on March of 2008, during the Public Governance Forum, Iloilo City presented its approach to financing development and was became the profession badge, having had its own Office for Strategy Management established in the city. Indeed, the city was able to sustain the growth in partnerships in accordance with its strategy map. It is the collaborative work that ensured the success of implementing the projects. The city has partnered with various non-government organizations and foundations. It has even shared the inter-LGO cooperation of the Metro Iloilo Guimaras Economic Development Council. It has also linked with and access funds from various overseas development agencies like JICA, GDC, USAID, USAID, World Bank, and CEDA. In the institutionalization stage, the OSM was now active and doing its work. The music was reorganized with the appointment of a new head and sector representatives. The roadmap and scorecard were revisited in the forum, and the OSM called the first meeting for the newly organized music in June of 2009. A workshop on performance report with the required template was conducted on July 8th, and the PGS scorecard was discussed. And ISA sent a solidarity mission to Iloilo City to validate the reported breakthrough with the results in July 2009. As a result of continuously striving to achieve the goals of the city, breakthroughs continued to pour in until they could be seen across all perspectives. The city started to get attention of event organizers as a popular venue for meetings, conventions, and exhibits. Going back to the present year, we now have this Iloilo Convention Center, or the ICC, a project of TESA, the DPWH, and facilitated by Senator Franklin DeLong, which stands proud as an icon of economic boom, boosting our growing reputation as an emerging mice for meetings. We are assured of even hosting at least the upcoming five Asia ASEAN-27 meetings and some pre-budget events of the Miss Universe in 2017. We also successfully hosted several APEC ministerial meetings last year. As a matter of fact, our tourism arrivals has increased to almost 1 million, with a city's population of only 500,000. As a result of the city's operation, especially of that of its OSM, One emerging breakthrough was a significant increase in its tax revenues, making its 2009 annual budget from 900 million in 2009, it is now about 2.1 billion pesos. The issuance of business permits way back in 2010 took about 10 months. But now, renewal of business permits with a one-stop licensing office only takes about 15 to 30 minutes. The computerization of the business permit processing resulted, of course, to a contented and happy customers. Where in the past, it took months in the processing time, now it has been reduced to a day. For the first time in the history of the city revenue collection program, the city was able to exceed the billion mark. As a matter of fact, the city of Iloilo is not era dependent. The days are over for Iloilo City to remain in the sideline. So in March of 2009, Iloilo City was one of the four cities which made its mark in an investment forum where the projects of the development of the Central Business District and the Parola Port Terminal were created. Today, we have built and opened the Parola Terminal through a private public partnership arrangement. Major infrastructure projects like the two highway flyover along General Luna Street, the double A slaughterhouse, the access roads, made life in the city more expedient. With the support of Senator Frank Rilon, the DPWH, the national government as agency partners, we have improved the service of our major roads and drainages. The new Central Business District is interconnected with West Road networks, wider green open spaces for work, travel, and leisure. What used to be a 6-lane is now a 10-lane road with two service roads as well as a bike lane that stretches about 24 kilometers and a pedestrian lane. If you will notice, this area, this expansion for a service road, it used to be an area full of informal settlers. About 1,000 informal settlers were there. And we were able to successfully move them out without a single form of protest or mass action from the residents themselves. With the addition of five more open universities, its tertiary education now boasts of 35 schools, 35 colleges, further strengthening its claim as the regional center. We have with us Central Philippine University, West Visayas State University, the University of San Agustin, St. Paul University, the University of the Philippines, Colegio del Sagrado Corazón de Jesus, the Colegio de San Jose, among the other 10 universities who have been existent in the city of Iloilo for more than 100 years now. Iloilo City's latest contribution is the creation of the Iloilo City Community College way back in 2012 that is fully subsidized by the Iloilo City government. And the city of Iloilo produces about 20,000 and that makes us with a 95.4 literacy rate according to the Department of Education. We are also offering free technical vocational courses through the city fully funded Technical Institute of Iloilo City that has greatly improved our edge in terms of skilled labor force with about 2,500 TechVoc graduates annually. They specialize in construction, automotive, electrical, carpentry, masonry, food processing, tailoring, food catering, among others. As what I said earlier, the Iloilo City College, Community College, was only established in 2012. And in 4 years' time, CHED broke its rule by accrediting City College, the City Iloilo City College, as one of its CHED accredited colleges and universities. For the environment, Iloilo City has undertaken projects that address environment concerns. The sanitary landfill conversion of the open dam site and the construction of the Iloilo floodway. The implementation of the boundary ordinance has regulated the entry of provincial vehicles into the city, thus greatly reducing carbon emissions to the environment. To build a public terminal would again be an additional cost for the city government. So what we did in the city of Iloilo for the implementation of the perimeter boundary ordinance was again to tell the private sector to go into a private-public partnership where it is the private sector that built these terminals in the city of Iloilo and have them operated it by themselves. Going back, now Iloilo City is among the few LGUs all over the Philippines to operate its own 13-hectare sanitary landfill within its 23-hectare property, some 7 kilometers away from the city center, as required by law of the Ecological Solid Waste Management Act. It was only inaugurated this August by no less than DNR Secretary Gina Lopez. Today, we are also working on a separate 5,000 square meter wastewater treatment plant intended for toxic and hospital wastes in the city of Iloilo. Being mindful of its responsibility to maintain a healthy and sustainable environment for its people, the former dump site is now host to a wedding eco park where couples in the city of Iloilo are required to plant a tree before getting married. Our love for environment is further anchored to the successful Iloilo River rehabilitation. What used to be a dead stagnant, fully silted river, full of illegal fish pens and about 500 illegal informal settlers settling on the river, has been moved to a better place. They have been moved and have been settled to a relocation site in partnership with the Gawad Kalinga and as well as the Urban Poor Association of the Philippines, where the informal settlers were moved. The relocation site is called the Iloilo River Plains Subdivision. Instead of the place being called the relocation site, we called it the Iloilo Subdivision to remove the stigma of being called relocatees from living in a relocation site. Now, the river has been successfully rehabilitated, and may I invite you, if you have time, to please come and see our river. In fact, all progress and development in the city is now connected to the river. The river became the catalyst of progress for the city of Iloilo. It includes the very popular 2.4-kilometer Iloilo River Esplanade that has been funded by the PDAF of Senator Franklin Drilon. Now, two more Esplanade projects will be established that will go straight up to the mouth of the river. If you would look at this river esplanade, you would think that you are in Singapore. Why? Because we got the designer, who is also the urban planner of the Singapore esplanade. And he is known as the Filipino renowned architect, Paulo Alcazar. In social development, the city has provided district health centers in 7 areas all over, bringing medical services nearer to the people. The services that we call is called the Cradle to Grave program. Cradle to Grave, meaning to say from the time that they were born up to the time that they died. Free medical services such as free ultrasound, free x-ray, free dialysis, free physical therapy sessions for stroke victims, free hospitalization by a field health program where a big portion of it is the city government who pays for the premium. Up to the point where we also provide free embalming for 3 months, good for 3 months. Free coffin, free service, and free use of cemeteries in the public cemeteries. Meaning to say, it's complete. The city was able also to get the cooperation of the Urban Poor Network, which helped find relocation sites for informal settlers. Of the 15,000 informal settler staff, in 2008, about 6,744 have already been relocated. Today, we are already in the 11,000 mark. So we have about 4,000 informal settlers left. These achievements are reflected in the high scores of Iloilo City in the Philippine City's competitive rating project conducted by the AIM Policy Center. Iloilo City ranked high in the following competitive drivers: human resources and training, infrastructure, and cost of doing business. Iloilo City presented its breakthrough results in an ESA open conference and thus was confirmed institutionalized on August 27, 2009. The first LGU in the Philippines that was confirmed as institutionalized in the ESEA Open Conference. With these landmark results, Iloilo City was inducted in the Palladium Hall of Fame for executing strategy in the Asia Pacific Summit held in Jakarta, Indonesia in 2009. In summary, the balanced scorecard provided a common language for everyone, for all the Ilocos of Iloilo City, to appreciate the alignment of the programs and projects with the vision of the organization. The delivery of the frontline services at City Hall improved, and public perception of government employees took a 180-degree turn. As a matter of fact, in 2005, when we had a survey time, public perception for Iloilo City was only in the way below 35% mark. But today, Iloilo City's approval net rating is hitting a 78% approval outstanding rating. All of these successes of the city came to us both as a reward and as a challenge. It is a reward because as constituents of the city, this has resulted to the combined efforts of the constituents. We were able to reap awards and recognitions. Thus, in 2010, there was a smooth transition of the leadership from the former mayor, now Congressman Jerry Peñas, to the new mayor. Yours truly, way back in 2010. So there was sustainability and continuity in the priorities of the programs that have been started, including the institutionalization of Iloilo City in the Palladium Hall of Fame by the Institute of Solidarity in Asia. Because of this, there was a big challenge. We knew that Iloilo City has not yet reached its full potential. In the beginning of our term, the previous head of the Office for Strategy Management left, and so we have to appoint a new one. We have to train a new one, and for this purpose, the new department heads and executive assistants who was part of the OSM have again to attend another set of ISAS bootcamp in 2010 for better comprehension and understanding of this program. Again, with the very active cooperation of the business sector, the relentless elderly and PWDs, the enthusiastic young sector, the health sector, the active council, the committed and hardworking people in the city hall, and all the other sectors, everyone was and continued to be part of this program. Since then, as a result, Iloilo City is first of the two cities in the Philippines that have been awarded the blue certification from the Ombudsman, which was personally given by then overall Deputy Ombudsman Melchor Arthur Caranda and Deputy Ombudsman for the Visayas Paul Clemente. Blue certification means that our services is transparent, fast and efficient, and has used technological innovations and has anti-red tape initiatives embedded in the system. This was a result of our continuing program to eradicate corruption and red tape within the city government. The resulting work of our efforts created an enabling environment for business to flourish and, more importantly, have earned the trust of our business sectors. If you are to look at this year's Cities and Municipalities Competitiveness Index Program, you can see that in 2011, our gross sales of registered firms is only about 63 billion pesos. In 2012, it increased by 17%, 74. In 2013, it increased by 6% to 79. It increased by another 7% in 2014, but with the effect of making Iloilo City a premier city in the year 2015, it had an increase of 23% giving us a 105 billion gross sales of registered firms. A first time in the history of the city of Iloilo. Next slide would also show that in the capitalization of new businesses, because of the improvement of our processing time, that aligned with the direction of our president, President Rodrigo Romo Duterte, that processing time should be done in 3 days' time, Iloilo City has complied with it until today, that as a matter of fact, figures would show that the capitalization of new businesses in 2011 would only show a 20 billion capitalization that increased in 2012 by about 96%, 726 billion, 2013 was only about 679, but we were able to recover in 2017 by 17% or 800 billion and in 2015, it increased by 671% with a 6,180,000,000 capitalization of new businesses in the city of Iloilo. Iloilo City today is considered as one of the most livable cities in the Philippines. Local inflation rate would show only a low of 2.9%. That would show that the value of money is more here in the city of Iloilo, meaning to say you can buy more of your peso here in the city of Iloilo. Cost of doing business, especially in electricity, has also decreased over these years, making Iloilo City competitive. Just recently, about a month ago, Iloilo City was recognized with the Seal of Good Local Governance National Award by the Department of Interior and Local Government for having exemplified commitment